Fox News alert on a busy Monday. President Trump taking on his critics and outlining his hopes for his second face-to-face meeting with North Korea's Chairman Kim Jong-un. The president set to depart the White House at any moment now, en route to a high-stakes summit in Vietnam. You're watching Outnumbered. I'm Harris Faulkner. Here today, Melissa Francis, host of Kennedy on the Fox Business Network, Kennedy herself, Fox News contributor Jessica Tarlov, and joining us in the center seat, Chris Wilson is here, Republican strategist and former pollster for the Ted Cruz campaign. Now, when I got all enthusiastic just then, you looked like I hadn't pronounced your name right.
It's Wilson.
Yeah. Oh, it's Wilson.
Traditional pronunciation.
It's great to see you.
Good to see you, too.
You ready to jump in?
Absolutely.
All right, let's do it. Well, this morning, during a gathering of the nation's governors at the White House, the president sounded optimistic that the North Korean regime is willing to give up its nuclear weapons. Watch.
We talk about something that, frankly, he never spoke to anybody about, but we're speaking, and we're speaking aloud, and I think we can have a very good summit. I think we'll have a very tremendous summit. We want denuclearization, and I think he'll have a country that will set a lot of records for speed in terms of an economy.
Yesterday, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo insisted President Trump will not repeat mistakes of the past, and drawing a sharp contrast with the policy of the Obama administration.
Test, pray, and cower has been upended by President Trump. We've put real economic pressure on the North Koreans. We've built out a global coalition. One of the critiques is that we go it alone. We've built out the world's coalition to communicate to Chairman Kim that now is the time, now is the moment, and I hope we'll make real progress on that this week.
But Democratic Senator Ed Markey says there is a risk Kim Jong-un will seek to extract concessions from the president without giving anything up himself. Watch it.
Kim wants to have a personal meeting with Trump, with hopes that he can, in fact, elicit concessions from President Trump that otherwise might not be possible if it was just our diplomats talking one-on-one. I think that he has to be very careful going in.
Meanwhile, a former CIA officer involved in high-level diplomacy with North Korea told a group on Friday about an alleged conversation between Secretary Pompeo and Kim Jong-un during Pompeo's visit to North Korea last April. That former CIA officer is claiming Kim Jong-un privately told Pompeo that he did not want his children to live with the burden of nuclear weapons. We bring it out to the couch. Chris, what would the significance of that be in terms of what we're trying to accomplish?
Well, listen to Markley. You know, here in the same generation of failed diplomacy advocates now criticize what the president is doing is a little bit tiresome to hear. I think what Donald Trump has been able to accomplish in a short period of time with sort of his aggressive brand of diplomacy is more than they had in their entire time under President Obama, and really going back almost for the last generation. Now, whether he's able to actually ever achieve anything or complete denuclearization remains to be seen. And frankly, it would be remarkable if he were, because the Kims don't care about anything other than enslaving their people and holding on power. But if they are able to take us a step further toward true denuclearization and what they've already accomplished, I think is significant in that category. It is frustrating for me to hear the Ed Markleys of the world continue to lob in criticism bombs whenever we're looking. We've actually moved further in a short period of time.
So what do you make of the former official from the CIA saying that Pompeo and Kim Jong-un supposedly had this conversation? None of us was in the room, so we can't quantify that. But that leader of North Korea didn't want to see his kids grow up in a world where nukes are.
Well, I would say it's encouraging if you do have North Korean leaders recognizing that the way in which their country has been developing, the fact that they were continuing to test nuclear weapons, is probably doesn't bode well for the future of their children's future and growing up in a world that is nuclear free. That is positive because it means there is at least the opportunity for us to be successful in achieving a denuclearized Korean peninsula.
So I thought it was interesting that it was put this way: test, pray, and cower was how we've always sort of seen the other side deal with this, Kennedy.
And I think that was a progression throughout various administrations, really starting with Bill Clinton, who set just a horrible tone for our diplomacy with North Korea. President Obama said when he left office that was the gravest threat posed to the United States and to the world was a nuclearized North Korea. And I think the fact that this administration has taken a completely different tack is better for the United States, and it certainly is better for peace. Now, Kim Jong-un talking about how he doesn't want his kids entrapped further in a world where they're held hostage by the necessity for nuclear weapons, I think the harder task Denuclearization is one thing. Yes, that's difficult. It takes a great deal of diplomacy, and it's very complex. What's harder is freeing those people, perhaps millions of people enslaved in labor camps in North Korea, and really allowing
a
level of freedom.
You're saying harder for him because he's got hardliners within his own country.
And that's really what caused the country to fall apart and cause a revolution from within. If people finally get a taste of freedom, we're not just talking about people who are experiencing economic immobility, but people who are truly being held against their will in some of the most dire circumstances on earth.
Yeah, and when you pick places like Singapore and Hanoi to let some of the leadership taste even for them, I mean, they're coming to it in trains with no windows, so they too don't have any freedom really, technically, but not like what you're talking about with those people. So the president tweeted this today. So funny to watch people who have failed for years. They got nothing telling me how to negotiate with North Korea, but thanks anyway. A lot of Democrats, Jessica, are critical of where the president is in going forward with this.
And a lot of Republicans are as well. John Bolton is probably the most cautious of anyone, certainly.
Well, cautious and criticism are two different things.
Well, there's been implicit criticism. If you even look at Mike Pompeo also sat down with Jake Tapper over the weekend and got into kind of an embarrassing exchange where he said, we want denuclearization. And Jake Tapper said, the president said that they aren't a nuclear threat. He said, no, that's not true. And Jake Tapper said, that's a direct quote. We had over the weekend, it came out that the president made comments that he would be satisfied with an end to testing. And this morning on Fox and Friends, Brian Kilmeade was pushing back against that and saying that should not be our goal. Denuclearization is the only appropriate goal for this. So when you listen to Senator Markley and some of the more hawkish members of the Republican Party, I think what they're asking for is consistency on this and to ensure that no matter how these meetings go down, that we know clearly what America is after and what we will settle for, and that the rest of it is unacceptable.
Talk to me about the economics of this, because changing their worldview is kind of what's happening.
So that's interesting, because when you look at other regimes and despotic regimes around the world, you can see that they're motivated by one of two things. You either have the ones that are motivated by wanting to hold on to power and have money, and then there are others that, you know, believe they've been destined by God to obliterate everybody else who doesn't agree with them. Obviously, that's a harder group of people to deal with. So when you look at Kim Jong-un or even Putin, you know, these are people where money means something to them and helps them with their ability to hang on to power. So bringing him to Hanoi is very interesting, because it's like, here's a government structure that we don't agree with, but we are able to trade with them and they are able to be prosperous. You don't have to be a democracy. And I think Kennedy makes a great point that the real problem is, how does he hold on to power and hold on to his grip with his own people and give them a little bit of freedom and give up the nukes? It's going to be very hard, but he has to feel like that's a possibility to start down the road of, number one, not threatening people with nuclear weapons. Then number two, after that, we then turn to the humanitarian situation in his own country. But to everyone who says that we haven't gotten anything so far, Ari Fleischer made a great point earlier today. They have to test those ballistic missiles in order to be able to use them to hit us. Yeah. So selfishly, we were talking about how that missile could hit Hawaii. And now that's not the case, because they're not testing those. So I know that's not nice for anyone else who's in the neighborhood, but it's inaccurate to say that nothing's been achieved because Americans are safer. We want that for everyone else, but that's just a point to be made.
No, it's very true. And what you were saying about the humanitarian situation over there, Kennedy, we haven't been able to impact. In fact, we haven't been able to put much pressure on China. But Hanoi, Vietnam, in a place where the Chinese would like to move into those seas as well. I mean, and then you see a deal potentially, not to go down too much on the business network side of this, but it's important because it's all the same story.
And when you look at Vietnam's economy, because it had completely collapsed when they went to an isolated communistic system. Mm-hmm. And then when they finally opened up their markets and became trading partners with the West and with the United States, you've seen a much healthier economy. And I think it's interesting because Singapore is still very authoritarian, and that's more of a model for Kim Jong-un. But Vietnam shows the fruits of free economy and global trade.
All right. The House expected to vote tomorrow on a resolution that would do away with President Trump's emergency declaration on the border. The measure likely to pass with Democratic support and could also pass the Senate with some GOP support. Missouri's Roy Blunt is one of those who could buck the president. Right now, he hasn't made up his mind.
I don't know yet. I don't like the process. I don't think that the emergency declaration law was written to deal with things that the president asked the Congress to do and then the Congress didn't do. It's never been used that way before. I want to look carefully at the law. I want to hear what the president's lawyers have to say about it.
But even if the measure lands on the president's desk, he has promised a veto, and lawmakers skeptical they would have the votes to override it. House Republican Adam Kitzinger recently got back from the Air National Guard deployment to the border, and he says the president is right about the situation down there. Watch.
I support the emergency declaration because when I went out there, there's a lot of immigration issues. We saw a lot of groups coming across the border illegally, but we saw a lot of drugs. We saw a lot of human trafficking. I've seen it. By the way, I've done three prior border deployments, all under President Obama. Okay, so it was never controversial under President Obama. If this was just an immigration issue, I probably would also agree it doesn't rise to the level of an emergency declaration. But this is drugs. This is human trafficking.
Meantime, nearly two dozen former congressional Republicans and a bipartisan group of 58 former national security officials have come out against the president's declaration. And Chris, I'll start with you. You know, what's interesting to me when you watch this come to the floor and you watch the vote counting, I haven't heard Nancy Pelosi ask for anything for the Dreamers in a really long time. I haven't heard her advocate on behalf of people. I'm only hearing the Democrats say no to what they won't do and what they're against. It feels like people have gotten forgotten in this, especially the Dreamers.
Well, it is, and this is nothing more than a stunt. And in the grand tradition of legislative stunt votes, it's not going to mean anything at the end of the day, because you mentioned even if it goes to the president, which is unlikely, he's going to veto it. But I'll tell you, my concern as someone who works for Republicans is what this does do, and I really wish every one of these Republicans that's going to vote against the president would sit down and listen to what Adam Kinzinger said this morning on Fox, is because it puts a lot of Republicans on the Senate, in which they are defending some blue to purple to blue type areas, on the wrong side of an issue that is not going to go well in their state. And frankly, it is. So it's a lot of people on our side, on the Republican side, setting up their colleagues to be in tougher situations to win re-election.
Jessica, I bet you disagree with that.
I don't. I purple states and counties are difficult for both sides here. I mean, the same goes for Democrats that are in more conservative districts who have to talk differently about border security than they do in, you know, New York City. Like, Jerry Nadler can say whatever he wants about it up here, but it makes a difference if you're down there. Kristen Sinema is indicative of that. She voted with the president over 50% of the time, actually, when she was in Congress. So it is difficult. But then there are Republicans like Will Hurd, whose constituency has a huge chunk of the border that we're talking about right here. And he says we don't need a wall. The problem has always been that the president made up an emergency when things got really bleak for him. He talked about it consistently through the first 2 years in the campaign, but then he suddenly got to a boiling point and said it's a national emergency when, yes, there are drugs coming, but they're going through points of entry, which means we have people there that are stopping them. The numbers do not bear out his argument that this is an emergency. We have, if you look at Border Patrol statistics, the numbers are going down over the last two decades. So when he gets up in the Rose Garden and he says, I didn't need to do this, but people are going to be skeptical and they don't want to set a bad
precedent. Don't we only know that they're going through the ports of entry because they're able to stop them there and we have people
right, but
there,
the point
but
is that
the ones
good
that are
enough,
going in everywhere else,
but we don't
you don't
have
know
that.
About
we
it.
Don't have, I mean, Sarah Sanders with Chris Wallace got schooled on that.
Well, the
about
president today, though,
had
a different take on that. He was saying that there are areas that are outside
the
that
president
are extremely
and I always have a different take.
Well,
so.
you can have a different take with the president, but we've also seen recently members of Congress down there eyeing it for themselves as well. Kinzinger is the only one that I know of who's deployed recently, but we've had congressional delegates go down there as well. So the point that I would make is it good enough just to protect those areas where we say ports of entry where we can keep up with it?
I think the difference is ports of entry versus national emergency. You can have a conversation about border security, but we're talking about declaring a national emergency, and that is the issue.
But if you listen to what Kinzinger described, I mean, what part of that do you not believe is an emergency?
I could do it, but I want to make sure Kennedy gets in.
I don't understand why you've got two different groups of people who go to two different parts of the border and see two completely different things. What I would like to see is both of them swap and see if there's any consistency with their reporting back of what's happening at the border, or if this is just a series of confirmation biases, which in that case, the whole thing is essentially a fraud and we're not getting the truth from anyone. If you want to know why drug cartels send drugs through ports of entry, you have to go back and read some of the testimony from the El Chapo trial, because he was the largest exporter of drugs into our country.
Point.
And they said that they went to these legal ports of entry because they could get a lot more drugs through those points.
In a big vehicle. There you go.
Submarines.
All right.
Tankers.
Comedian Bill Maher mocking people in red states as being less educated and earning less money than people in blue states. Whether that kind of elitism bodes badly for Democrats in 2020. Plus, House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff vows to subpoena the Mueller report if the DOJ doesn't make it public. Whether this is all about Russia or if Democrats have a larger agenda, we'll debate.
There's never been a witness who's alleged conspiracy between the Trump campaign and Russia. And yet Adam Schiff, that three-eyed raven, Adam Schiff, who can see things nobody else can see.
Be better for life, for less.
We are giving you a live look right now of Air Force One. It is sitting on the tarmac there at Joint Base Andrews. We expect the president to arrive soon on Marine One and board Air Force One. He is on his way. He's going to ride by motorcade, pardon me, en route to Hanoi, Vietnam, for those talks with Kim Jong-un. We expect him to maybe make a comment or two. We're not sure. You never know.
Well, he always does that with Marine One, but we know here on the East Coast, these winds are vicious right now, right?
That's
true. You can hear them in the studio.
But remember when he got out of the motorcade and he went over to the sidelines before? He's done that.
Yeah,
not there,
he sometimes will do it. We don't know.
We'll see.
But we're on it.
All right, thank you. We'll bring it to you live when it happens.
A top Democrat in Congress is saying he's ready to haul Robert Mueller before his committee if the special counsel is not sufficiently forthcoming with the results of his investigation of the president. House Intelligence Committee Chairman Adam Schiff spoke yesterday, insisting there is evidence that President Trump colluded with Russia. Collusion's not a crime. And vowing to make sure the entire special counsel report is made public, even if new Attorney General William Barr withholds some information. Watch.
We will obviously subpoena the report. We will bring Bob Mueller in to testify before Congress. We will take it to court if necessary. And in the end, I think the department understands they're going to have to make this public. I think Barr will ultimately understand that as well. If he were to try to withhold, to try to bury any part of this report, that will be his legacy, and it will be a tarnished legacy. So I think there'll be immense pressure not only on the department, but on the attorney general to be forthcoming.
Former Republican House Oversight Chair Trey Gowdy, with Game of Thrones reference, telling Maria Bartiromo on Sunday Morning Futures that Chairman Schiff apparently sees evidence no one else can.
There's never been a witness who's alleged conspiracy between the Trump campaign and Russia. And yet Adam Schiff, that three-eyed raven, Adam Schiff, who can see things nobody else can see, says he has evidence more than circumstantial, not quite direct. By the way, for those who didn't go to law school, there's no such thing. There's no such thing as evidence that is not circumstantial or direct. But Adam has seen it, and he's never pressed on it.
Meanwhile, Attorney General William Barr said in his confirmation hearing he would be as transparent as possible with the Mueller report, and there is precedent involved here, as the Justice Department has released everything Republicans requested in the Hillary Clinton email investigation. DOJ also released the Starr report and Leon Jaworski's Watergate investigation. Chris, where are we going here?
Oh, gosh. You know, Adam Schiff, the leading light of Russian conspiracy theories, was always going to release every single word of this that fits his theory as to what happened. And any part that's classified that he's not allowed to release or would be illegal to release, he'll leak to the Washington Post, the New York Times. That was always going to happen. And it shouldn't surprise anyone. He's been doing the same thing since the beginning of this. And he's always been rogue out there. And I don't know what the Trey Gowdy's references mean. So someone will have to explain those to me about the Game of Thrones reference. But from a standpoint of what Schiff is going to do, what he believes fits his narrative, and it doesn't matter what the evidence shows.
So is that your opinion? Because you said, well, he's done it before.
Yeah, he has. I think you can look back since the beginning of this process. Adam Schiff has been the one who's been leaking what's been going on, and anything that's made its way out, which has been pretty tight. I mean, you gave the Mueller team credit in terms of keeping things close to the vest. So anything that...
Well, that's why he has bipartisan support.
That's right. You're exactly right.
Schiff is going to be so mad if that report is tepid.
Well, some Democrats have already talked about what they're going to do if it's not quite there. In the meantime, I'll tell you what is there. The president is at Joint Base Andrews getting ready. Do you hear that wind?
Yeah.
You can hear it. That's
right,
why they're in a motorcade. It usually takes Marine One to get there, to Air Force One. But it's very windy conditions for that type of craft, I would imagine. So they made a call to be on the ground. And so here we are. And we are waiting for the president to leave for a history-making summit. Look, the first one was with the dictator of North Korea, Kim Jong-un. Mm. And now we're looking at a second summit with the president of the United States and Kim Jong-un. And what will be achieved from this? Denuclearization has been the goal, and there has been some criticism, you may be seeing that, about the special envoy that we have with North Korea right now. Some are critical that we may be giving too much away in terms of sitting down and having this much conversation with a brutal regime. But as Kennedy was pointing out a while ago, they've got upwards of millions of people in custody, human rights situations in that country. And there is the president of the United States as he boards Air Force One. How much of a difference can our president make? Well, it's already changing in the sense of we are talking with that country.
Melissa? It's interesting to put it in perspective of how the American people are feeling about this as we watch the president get aboard the plane. Recent Fox News poll, President Trump on North Korea, approve or disapprove his policy so far? 46% approve, 41% do not approve. U.S. taking military action to stop North Korea's nuclear weapons program. Right now, 49% in favor of military action to stop the program, 37% oppose it. Now, that number is down a little bit from April. It was at 53. But, Chris, to me, that says that, you know, people feel threatened. They feel concerned about this risk out there.
Well, they feel threatened and concerned, but the bigger aspect of it is they're willing to do something about it. And I think that's the unique aspect of the numbers you pointed out, because you could look at our relationship with other countries. If you were to look, for instance, at Venezuela today, I think there is, you could argue that there is a national threat to us coming out of South America, but at the same time, you don't see those same sort of support for taking action against them or even intervening in the current situation there. And that, to me, is what's interesting about it, because you do have, I mean, right now, you've got to put everything that goes on, and it's somewhat cynical, but this is what I do for a living. You've got to put all of it into the prism of what does it mean for a re-election. And if the president is able to come out of North Korea, or he's able to make a claim that he has somehow taken us further down the road to a denuclearized North Korean peninsula, if he's able to push Kim further along in the process of lightening up on his people, then that is a positive for him. And I think that's a big deal.
Kennedy, I want to get in with this point because I had mentioned it loosely. And again, the president is aboard Air Force One, leaving shortly for Hanoi, Vietnam. It's about a 20-hour plane ride normally commercially. I'm going to think that they might be able to get there a little bit quicker, but we'll see. We'll be covering it every length of the way here. A senior administration official tells Fox News the White House, State Department, DOD, Treasury, even Energy are expressing concern about President Trump's special envoy to North Korea, Stephen Belgum. Is he going to, and this is a quote, getting too far over his skis with negotiations with North Korean officials? So even going into this summit, there is some reported criticism per a senior administration official talking with Fox News. Kennedy, what do you make of it?
I don't think that these talks are implicitly harmful. Of course, I would like to know that the president has a solid agenda and is incredibly focused on extracting something that is not only to our benefit, but makes the world a better, more peaceful place. And the more talks we have and the more we lean on the side of trade and having goods move back and forth, the less you see a military threat. And, you know, the one thing that North Korea is asking for is for the United States to ease up on their alliance with South Korea doing military exercises in their backyard. And the president has said that, you know, perhaps we have too many military bases open all over the world. And, the one good thing about his presidency, you could say, is the unorthodox strategery.
Well, and he's been talking about it since the campaign trail, you know, that idea of what makes us better and deployment and all the such. You know, he's had an interesting morning talking Chinese trade. It's had a positive effect on the Dow Jones. This president making news, having a positive effect, if you will, in terms of talking with Chinese leadership as he gets ready to take off for Hanoi, Vietnam. Air Force One, center of your screen, we're covering it, and we'll come right back to it. We're going to take a quick break, though. Virginia's Democratic Lieutenant Governor Justin Fairfax is facing new controversy today over his latest response to the sexual assault allegations against him. Critics say his rhetoric crossed the line. Details ahead. The gloves come off here, though. Democrats face a growing split over the Green New Deal pushed by Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Now that freshman Democrat is ripping Senator Dianne Feinstein for her comments. Really, it was a lecture. To young students about the progressive proposal, the impact of it all. We'll debate it. Stay close.
I know what I'm doing. You come in here and you say it has to be my way or the highway. I don't respond to that.
Senate Republicans looking to put Democrats in a tough spot, forcing a vote as early as this week on the controversial Green New Deal, co-sponsored by liberal Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. The proposal would not become law, but a vote will force Senate Democrats, including 2020 candidates, to reveal where they stand on it. Some have already said they support it. In the meantime, there's a viral video of Democratic Senator Dianne Feinstein speaking to student activists about the Green New Deal. The senator was mostly cordial. There are a few feisty moments in there. Watch this.
You know what's interesting about this group is I've been doing this for 30 years. I know what I'm doing. You come in here and you say it has to be my way or the highway. I don't respond to that. I've gotten elected. I just ran. I was elected by almost a million vote plurality. And I know what I'm doing. So, you know, maybe people should listen a little bit.
But Ocasio-Cortez ripping into Feinstein's remarks in an Instagram post. Watch this.
I don't think that working on an issue for 30 years alone is what qualifies, is what makes someone qualified to solve an issue. A lack of urgency is going to kill us.
Feinstein, in a statement to USA Today, not apologizing, but saying, quote, I want the children to know that they were heard loud and clear. I have been and remain committed to doing everything I can to enact real, meaningful climate change legislation. We had a spirited discussion. I presented the group with my draft resolution that provides specific responses to the climate change crisis. And I'm sure those kids read that draft document. Right away, Kennedy.
Absolutely. And they sounded out the words that they didn't understand.
No doubt. There's so many places to go here with this, because that was an astonishing video. You wonder, how did those kids get there? Where were their parents? Who sent them? All that kind of stuff. But what do you think of the dem-on-dem violence here around?
It's propaganda at work. And, you know, I don't agree with Dianne Feinstein on a lot. And, you know, I've spent the better part of my life in California, and I don't think she's always represented the state well. But, you know, for the number of years she's been in office, she's earned the right to say, don't come into my office, use kids as a pawn, and try to bully me into a resolution that, if this were legislation that were enacted, would cost $80 trillion over 10 years. It is impossible. It is wholly unsustainable. And that's why, you know, there are moderate Democrats who are taking a step back, saying, okay, what can we do? What can we abstract from this that we can actually enact together that would make the environment cleaner and make everyone feel safer and better? It's not the Green New Deal. I mean, this stuff, it's malarkey, nonsense, garbage.
Yeah. What do you think about a group that would get together with cameras and send, you know, kids in there to confront and sort of embarrass Dianne Feinstein? Her response now, it's, you know, all over TV. And then you see AOC go on while she's cooking at the counter or whatever she's doing, and she sort of weighs in on the whole thing. I mean, what are your thoughts on that as a Democrat?
I don't like it one bit. I mean, the Sunrise Movement, who is behind this, is a dark money political organization that is out there for manipulation and to stir things up, which they've done. This happens on both sides of the aisle, that kids are used as pawns this way. And used the first video of Dianne Feinstein was only 3 minutes long. That was a 14-minute interaction, actually, which finally came out after everyone had exploded that she was the meanest grandma in the whole world. You know, She does have, I think AOC is wrong to say that 30 years of activism on this issue doesn't matter, because it does matter, and she has her own climate change bill on top of that. But when I was watching that, I saw Bernie Sanders, younger versions, versus Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton saying, hey, we need to know how to pay for these things. We need a policy that can actually be implemented and can pass. And Bernie saying, hey, I'm on my unicorn. Here's the Medicare for All and the free college tuition. And this is the fight that AOC wants to have with moderate Democrats. And it didn't work out in 2018.
You know what I see? I see an opening for Republicans to get in there. Because, you know, and it is true that the freebies are something that everybody says that they want until they realize how much it costs. Yeah. And change is what everybody says they want until they realize what certain avenues cost. So if Republicans can get in there, Chris, and come up with something that works, not like what just happened in California, where they spent $3.5 billion of our dollars on mismanagement and blah 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 blah. And now the high rail speed thing is not going to happen.
Famous for that,
but Republicans have some ideas out there too. And so why not come in and put forth their own package of ideas before the next round?
Well, yes, I think that is the right approach. But I'll tell you, I mean, first on Feinstein, I mean, that video sounded like my last flight I took to Orlando, the background noise of all the kids yelling and things. The fact that she kept her cool for as long as she did was remarkable to me. But I'll say the vote on this, what McConnell's doing, I think is absolutely brilliant. Force Democrats to own or reject what is really socialism thinly disguised as environmentalism. And it's nothing more than some hipster design takeover of the economy. And that is, I mean, once you split the Democrats down the middle on who's going to support that and who's going to reject that, I think it really is a nice setup for a Republican
solution. It's actually even more nefarious than that, because it is a money grab where they're funneling money from taxpayers to other corporations, and it's destroying lives in the process. People whose energy goes through the roof and people who lose their jobs. So it's more nefarious.
And how many cows have to die?
Well, I was being serious, but I hear you. A new firestorm in Virginia after the embattled lieutenant governor invokes a dark chapter of the nation's past, comparing himself to the victim of lynchings, the fierce reaction, and whether this creates new headaches for Democrats. Sing along if you know it. New developments in the scandals roiling Democrats in Virginia. Embattled Lieutenant Governor Justin Fairfax facing calls to resign over two sexual assault allegations against him, and now raising eyebrows in an impromptu Senate floor speech comparing himself to lynching victims. Watch.
And I've heard much about anti-lynching on the floor of this very Senate, where people were not given any due process whatsoever. And we rue that. We talk about hundreds, at least 100 terror lynchings that have happened in the Commonwealth of Virginia under those very same auspices. And yet we stand here in a rush to judgment with nothing but accusations and no facts. And we decide that we are willing to do the same thing.
The Republican majority leader in the Virginia House of Delegates blasting Fairfax's remarks, saying they are, quote, the most disgusting type of rhetoric he could have invoked. But the Democrat chair of Virginia's Black Caucus says he's heard similar language from his constituents. Fairfax's remarks come as Virginia Republicans vow to hold hearings. One of his accusers, Meredith Watson, issued a statement through her lawyer saying she would publicly testify against Fairfax. So this is certainly getting messier, but I understand where Justin Fairfax is coming from, and that the two men who are on either side of him in terms of ascendancy to the governorship are both embattled in claims of racism.
Right.
Yet here Justin Fairfax is being singled out for claims of sexual assault. So what is the appropriate venue? Should there be public hearings in the House of Delegates, like some Republicans who control that chamber, like they want? Or is this a law enforcement issue, as lieutenant government is claiming?
I feel like that's a little bit above my pay grade, but I do think that his accuser,
what's the best
Dr.
way
Tyson,
to get to the truth here?
Does deserve a public airing of these. We, in the Brett Kavanaugh hearings, we heard from Dr. Ford in a very public hearing, and I think that that helped all of us to better understand the issue, and we came down on different sides of it in many cases, but that was the way forward. I think there is an issue, though, even if your constituents have said something, with public leadership using that kind of terms or speaking in that way. Yeah. You know, last night at the Oscars, listening to Spike Lee after he won for Black Klansman, which deals with real lynchings and what the history in this country.